Digital access is the sole electronic participation in society and is the ability to access online materials through computer or software and the understanding of what you're doing, so you're not just like clicking around and lost. And it's becoming an increasing factor in education, both by people outside the classroom and in the classroom, like students with their computers at home or in the classroom and smart boards and stuff. It starts with the, about a decade ago, the digital divide was the term used to explain the split in electronical kind of word. I don't know what I'm looking for. But people who know what they're doing and know how to get online freely, and people who don't have easy access to this material. And over the last decade, little's been done to really bridge the gap between the two. And nowadays, only the bigger cities are really doing anything to do it, like Chicago, Philadelphia, and Miami all have centers. Like they go to senior centers and try to help senior citizens access the internet, and they're putting it in more computers and libraries and park districts, which is, and then out of all Americans, only 68% have access to regular internet use, and then like 26% of people over 60 know have internet access. People who didn't graduate high school may have 29%, and then Hispanics have 37. Americans with disabilities are a little higher with 38, and then 57% of African Americans have internet access. Some of the missions are done is most successful when you focus on low-income families, children, seniors, and then people with disabilities. And like I said, they're putting more, like, Wi-Fi in areas like parks and libraries and senior centers to help give them access to the internet that they didn't have before. And this is the main source I use. Yeah. Yay.
He had an initiative that he used the prisoners in our schools. So why I'm talking, number five, get ready to go. Okay, so connect your computer, group five, you're next, okay? He wired all of our schools in South Dakota using prisoner labor. They came in, and you see them, this room was redone since then, but they're like out in the hallways, you see a lot of internet ports with plugins. That was all done with prisoner labor. And it was very cheap. He did that back in probably the 90s, and that was probably, we are one of the only states that have done that, and all of our public school systems got it. So all of the Regental system, the South Dakota Regental schools, all were wired pretty much free. Schools didn't have to pay, they just had to put those prisoners up for the evening and feed them while they were in your school district. So, sort of good. Good things happen. Are you ready to go?
Yeah, we're going to use this.
Okay. Okay, let me send yours to the screen.
All right, we have digital etiquette. And that is a basic set of rules you should follow to make the internet a better place for other people and yourself. And it's also a code of conduct for having good manners and treating others with respect. And important for many things, including video games, emails, blogs, and social networking sites. And it's also easy to stay anonymous, so people often say things they wouldn't say in person.
Okay, so one major part of digital etiquette has to do with email, and email is like one of the areas that it's most concerned with, because emails, it's hard to like interpret what people are saying. Like, we've all had those emails like from teachers or like other people, and we're like, oh, are they mad at us? Because you can't like get those facial expressions. So one way to help with this is just to keep things short and to the point and make them easy to understand, and always go back and reread what you said just to make sure that it does make sense. Also, slang is okay when talking to friends, but not when you're trying to be formal, like sending an email to a teacher or a potential employer. Also, using smileys, it's okay if it's like your friends, but try and use them sparingly. And then make sure you have an appropriate email address for sending emails to teachers and stuff like that. And this is an example of what you wouldn't want to send to your teacher. So just like using short words or like the slang that we talked about.
Okay, another huge part is social media. It's important when you're displaying things on the internet not to use all caps. This makes people think you're very angry or overly maybe excited or you're yelling at them. Another important thing is stay away from a lot of excessive punctuation marks. And you can see anything on the internet, whether you think it's private or not, so don't post things you wouldn't want your teachers or a principal or future employer to see. And then this goes along with the email. You know, reread what you write before you send so you can make sure you're, you know, spelling things correctly, making sure your grammar is correct. And another important thing is to make sure that you ask your friends for permission for posting things on their webpage. And it's also important to remember that humor and sarcasm are not easily picked up in writing. And if you're using the internet, make sure you cite all sources.
And then all the things that we talked about, they're not specific to just email or just social networking. Like, they apply across all aspects, but they're more easily applied to certain pieces of it.
Good job.
Coming up to hook up. One of the things I have to say that in workplace, I've worked in elementary schools or in a K-12 school. I've worked as a consultant and I've worked now at the higher ed. One of the easily misled thing is when somebody talks or somebody emails somebody else and they assume that they're angry or they said things they didn't really intend to, because emails are misinterpreted. So probably be very careful, because even in a workplace, you can step on toes, or people assume when you send them an email that things are a little bit different. So just watch what you do. I'm going to switch a couple of things. So we should be good.
All right, our presentation is on digital health and wellness.
Okay, first we have eye safety. Many people spend like a lot of time with computers and stuff, and due to staring, some people tend to develop eye strain, and when you're on a computer for a long time, eye safety is important for your health and wellness. Some symptoms of eye strain are red, watery, irritated eyes, tired, aching, or heavy eyelids, problems with focusing, muscle spasms of the eye or eyelid, headache, and backache. Ways to prevent eye strain are position the computer farther away from you, minimize light, reflections, and glares, take breaks on focusing to reduce eye fatigue, and keep the eyes lubricated. So basically what we're saying is when you're on computer for like 6 hours, like take breaks in between like 30-minute time periods and give your eyes a break.
Okay, I have repetitive stress syndrome, which covers basically anything when you're on the computer. It's a disorder where it's an injury to a part of the body that is caused by overusing or exerting too much stress on that body part. So basically it's proper, like how to sit on the computer. You should have your back straight, your elbows should be in, your hands should be in with your elbows. I don't know. It's, I have a video that'll show it too. Some stress disorders that come along with it are carpal tunnel syndrome, tennis elbow, trigger finger, tendonitis, and blackberry thumb. And this video has no sound, I guess, so if you watch along with it, kind of goes body part by body part, what you're supposed to do.
I'm sure you all do that in your dorm room, right? Mm-hmm.
A big one that I noticed when I was researching is your back is one that you wouldn't think about necessarily. Like, one example was sitting on your couch or on your chair and you're leaning or you're laying down, which I do all the time. You're supposed to sit just straight up. Another one was like this, your wrists and your hands a lot, not only with computers, but with your cell phone as well. People are getting carpal tunnel from typing and texting especially. That's how you are supposed to sit at a computer.
Okay, so sound ergonomic practices is basically the way to sit in a chair, kind of like the video showed, and how to be at your computer comfortably without injuring your back. Having a backrest is important on your chair and actually using it. Keeping your feet flat, don't cross your legs. And all these will help prevent being tired and injury from being at your computer too much. It's important to keep your keyboard flat so you don't develop carpal tunnel. And your mouse, or your shoulders, and your arms should be relaxed and your wrists straight. And your mouse near the keyboard so you don't have to stretch or be in any awkward position. And you want to have your screen adjusted so it doesn't have a glare from lights and windows. And you want it around eye level so you don't have to bend your neck and hurt yourself. And it's important to keep your screen clean too so you can see what you're doing.
And then along with digital health and wellness, the more time you spend on a computer, like the worse it is for you. And a lot of times when you're on the computer, you're doing things on the internet. And some signs that you're like addicted to the internet is you're like lying about how much time you're spending on the computer, or you're lying about what you're doing. You might be like, oh, I was writing a paper for 6 hours, that's why I was on the computer, but really you were on Facebook for 5 hours. Also another warning sign is excessive fatigue and changes in sleeping habits. You might get up early or stay up late so you can be on the computer or on the internet. Also, your academic performance might worsen. So if you're in class and you're again on Facebook or Twitter and not paying attention, then you're not doing as good in class. And also, sometimes people withdraw from their friends and their hobbies so they can spend time on the internet. Sometimes they're irritable and they're cut off when they're cut off from their computer use, and also they're disobedient or acting out.
Okay, some other issues that can occur are psychological issues such as cyberbullying and cyberstalking. And there's also not a lot of social interaction if you're sitting on the computer and you don't build vital social skills that you need. You're spending less time outdoors, and there's not a lot of activity involved with sitting on the computer, so you're not getting that physical activity that you need to lead a healthy lifestyle.
Okay, let's go to you guys for 8. So we're on number 3. Are you ready to go?
Okay, so we had digital communication, and digital communication has changed the way we communicate to pretty much everyone. We can now keep in constant contact with anyone, and we have a video that shows some of the highlights of that.
Tile presents the evolution of communication technology. Did you know that communication is changing? Technology is responsible for the way we communicate. As technology improves, the speed in which these changes happen increases. It took 38 years for radio to have 50 million users. TV took 13. The internet took 4 years, while Facebook took less than 3. Google totally changed the way people found products and services. And by the year 2000, they were leading the way in search-based advertising. Social media is the latest evolution in communication. Only now are people realizing that social media can help people connect with products and services in a much more meaningful way. $2 billion of advertising revenue was generated by Facebook last year as advertisers look to make the most out of social media. Society is forever evolving in line with their communication strategies. Baby boomers are most comfortable with face-to-face communication, whilst Generation X are great on telephone as well as written and email communication. Generation Y have become avid social networkers and texters. Communication is changing. Don't get left behind. Connect with us today at Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, or LinkedIn.
Okay, and so now we have a few things that the video hit on. We kind of went a little bit more in depth. Facebook is used to stay connected with friends and family. Facebook and Skype actually partnered together, so now you can do video conferences and chats. Then they also have a very useful chat function, and there's also a calendar where you can invite friends, and they have the option to post pictures and tag friends and keep everyone connected. And then Twitter, we said you can have brief messages to smaller audiences, and one of the things that I know I use Twitter for is to like follow celebrities, so that's more of like the non-personal, and it's very informal and abbreviated direct messaging for private conversations. Majority of users are the younger audience, so like the younger generation, and small messages and pictures are called tweets. And then email, this is the more professional digital communication. It made it easier to send less information more often, so like as opposed to letters, I assume, and then somewhat easier to access since the creation of smartphones. Not as convenient as instant messaging and texting, but it is, like I said, used for more professional messages such as professors and coworkers. And then texting is the more personal digital communication, unlike email, texting is used for more immediate messaging amongst personal friends. And most of the time, messages are short responses with no greeting or ending, and use shorthand spelling to decrease the time it takes between messages. And there's our slides.
Okay. Very good.
We're going to give four a break. We're going to jump back to six, because I think six is finally up and running. It took us a while to get it to project, but we got it there. Okay.
Okay, we had digital law. It deals with the ethics of technology within a society. And it's anything from stealing or causing damage to people's work, identity, or property online. The users need to be aware of normal ethics and morals while using the internet. And the laws apply to anyone hacking into others' information, downloading illegal music, plagiarizing, creating destructive works, viruses, or creating Trojan horses, sending spam, or stealing anyone's identity or property is unethical. It's just a video that we have.
$1,000 for a bunch of the music that he downloaded off LimeWire.
Yes. How much do you think you could be sued per song?
A lot. $1 to $5 is a guess.
A lot?
Okay, plagiarizing and consequences. Appropriating the writings, graphic representation, or ideas of another person to represent them as one's own work without proper attribution. 1.4 billion pages are on the internet, 25 pages being added every second. 38% of undergraduate students have used the internet for plagiarizing work in the past year, and up to $25,000 in fines or 10 years in jail are some of the consequences that can be considered, depending on how severe it is. And the original author or publisher can sue for violation of copyright laws. Just some proper etiquette for digital law while you're using the internet is consider what you are using. Always be alert to what you are calling your own. Think before you steal and cite your sources and give credit to authors. Be considerate to the people who put in hard work to create the work for you. For your own entertainment, and know your boundaries and understand all consequences.